Welcome to the webinar on Aspergillus antigen testing. My name is Professor David Denning and I work at the University of Manchester. I've been involved in diagnosis of aspergillosis for over 30 years. Today I'm going to take you through several areas related to Aspergillus antigen, including some learning objectives and patterns of aspergillosis, then which tests do what with respect to making a diagnosis, talk a little bit about galactomannan, then we'll go through three of the assays that are available, and then I'll discuss interpreting different results and how these are interpreted and the potential use also for histoplasmosis and enteromycosis. So our learning objectives for this session are to understand the different clinical presentations of aspergillosis, to understand how to select appropriate tests and sample types for these presentations, to understand how to perform antigen testing using different commercial kits, including one lateral flow device, and then interpretation of those test results in the clinical context. So there are four main patterns of aspergillosis. There is invasive aspergillosis, which occurs primarily in immunocompromised patients and usually affects the lungs, but it may affect other organs, as you know. Chronic pulmonary aspergillosis occurs in non-immunocompromised patients or patients with very subtle immune defects, such as on low-dose steroids. Allergic aspergillosis is a form particularly of allergic bronchopulmonary aspergillosis, or ABPA, and you can have that in asthma or cystic fibrosis. And you can also have allergic aspergillosis in the sinuses with various forms of allergic aspergillus rhinosinusitis. Other common manifestations of aspergillosis include keratitis following injury to the cornea of the eye, otitis externa, which is quite a challenging problem in some patients, aspergillus bronchitis, which can be confused or can occur alongside ABPA patients or be independent of ABPA and asthma, but is more common in bronchiectasis, and onychomycosis, which is typically of the toenails, occurring in 1-3% of patients with toenail infections. So there are some general other observations to make, such as the fact that invasive aspergillosis can disseminate to the brain, the heart, and the guts, but none of the other forms of disease disseminate. There's also an unfortunate form of aspergillosis following surgery, known as postoperative aspergillosis, and when there are difficulties with air quality in operating rooms, then you can get aspergillosis following surgical procedures such as endocarditis in a replacement valve or cerebral aspergillosis or infection following breast reconstruction and so on. Aspergillus can also cause colonization of the nose. In fact, it's very commonly found in the nose if a culture is done. It can colonize the sinuses without causing disease and all the lungs as well. So distinguishing colonization from infection is a key element of the diagnostic process. So another way of thinking about these patterns of disease are that patients with immune dysfunction have invasive aspergillosis. That can be temporary immune dysfunction, such as patients admitted to intensive care or patients who just acquired influenza and are very ill, or it can be long-standing, as in patients who've had a transplant. Then you have chronic disease, which is a little bit more common overall because of the prevalence of chronic pulmonary aspergillosis, but it's an outpatient disease rather than an inpatient disease primary. And it occurs in people with damaged or impaired lung function. And then you have allergic aspergillosis, particularly ABPA, but also exacerbating asthma and cystic fibrosis. So which tests are useful for which of these conditions? The radiological appearances of invasive pulmonary aspergillosis are quite heterogeneous. There are a couple of characteristic features. The first is shown on this slide, and that is the halo sign. This is an area of ground glass surrounding a nodular infiltrate, or sometimes an area of consolidation. And this is very typical of invasive pulmonary aspergillosis, but can also be seen in mucormycosis and in fusarium infection of the lung and occasionally in Pseudomonas. Over time, this appearance, which is usually seen in neutropenic patients, can change and you can end up with cavitation and an air crescent sign, as shown in this slide. In the left lung with the red arrow, you can see an area of fairly disorganized consolidation, but then a very obvious halo sign or black area around a nodular area. And in this case, this is a dead area of lung infarcted from the angioinvasion from pulmonary aspergillosis. And another term for this is the lung sequestrum. And this gradually resolves over time and is actually a form of healing from invasive aspergillosis and is therefore a late feature of the disease, not an early feature, which is what the halo sign represents. But a much larger number of patients have non-specific infiltrates. Here are two examples in the hematology setting with bilateral areas of consolidation which are not particularly distinctive. And the only feature that's particularly associated with invasive pulmonary aspergillosis is that it's bilateral. And it's also demarcated by the fissure. You can see in the invasive aspergillosis in multiple myeloma, the right lung, the fissure is very obvious. And this is very typical of invasive pulmonary aspergillosis, but not specific for it. In this final illustration, I want to make the point that the chest x-ray is often normal in invasive pulmonary aspergillosis, and that's an example here. And to the immediate right of that chest x-ray is a CT scan from that same patient with a small nodule with a very indistinct area of ground glass around it and an even smaller nodule on the right lung. And this is early invasive pulmonary aspergillosis. If the diagnosis can be made at this time, the patient's much more likely to survive. And as I say, the chest x-ray is usually normal at this stage. So a CT scan is much more sensitive than a chest x-ray, but it's not 100% sensitive for this disease. And even further to the right of your screen, you'll see some examples in the blue box with some very early ground glass shadowing. This is also very early invasive aspergillosis. And again, if the diagnosis can be made at this stage, the patient's much more likely to survive. So to summarize, a halo sign is seen in neutropenia, an air crescent sign or cavitation is a characteristic feature of invasive pulmonary aspergillosis, but not very often seen. Much more commonly, you see non-specific areas, consolidation, atelectasis, which may be demarcated by fissures as a clue to the diagnosis, even though that's not specific. So another important means of making some diagnosis of aspergillosis is with microscopy. This is usually a direct microscopy on a respiratory fluid, typically on bronchoalveolar lavage fluid, but it can also be done on sputum, and we do this on sputum in our centre. And if you see fungal hyphae, then it's extremely likely that that patient has a fungal infection. This is not going to be colonization. And the only question is, which fungus is it? Many fungal hyphae look similar, but it is a very important means of distinguishing mucormycosis from aspergillosis and other hyaline molds. And you can see in the original randomized study of fluvaroconazole, when it was compared with amphotericin B, that quite a lot of the patients were enrolled on microscopy, which reflects, I think, the utility of this test as a rapid diagnostic test. And if this is done routinely, this can be very helpful, particularly in combination with galactomannan or other tests where maybe some uncertainty about the diagnosis. This gives you a much greater level of certainty. Respiratory fluids is the next important approach to making a diagnosis of invasive pulmonary aspergillosis and other forms of pulmonary aspergillosis. So it's important to note that bacteriological media are inferior to fungal media for identifying Aspergillus or growing it. The yield from BAL or sputum is only about 30%, so this is not a reliable rule-out test, but it's helpful if it's positive. Cultures can take 1 to 10 days to grow, and unless they're very obvious and candidate early, can take longer to identify. If you send more samples, you can have a higher yield, and we also now know that higher volume cultures are more sensitive. And you can grow Aspergillus from the nose and in patients with invasive Aspergillus rhinosinusitis, but it's not always possible to be sure whether this represents disease or not unless you have other characteristic features. There is a little bit of work comparing PCR with culture yield in patients. These two tests appear to be very similar in terms of their yield in COPD patients, but otherwise Aspergillus PCR is probably more sensitive than culture, particularly in invasive disease. The quality of the sample is very important, and in the laboratory, very watery samples should be discarded for fungal culture, although they can be used for pneumocystis PCR because the pneumocystis DNA gets lodged in the airways and mouth. It is not helpful to know what the colony count is. The yield is so difficult to get reliable results with Aspergillus cultures that it's really not helpful. And if you find a plate which is full of Aspergillus, it's as likely to represent laboratory contamination as disease. The only possible exception is patients with Aspergillus tracheobronchitis who may have very high fungal counts. So you can also detect Aspergillus galactomannan in respiratory fluids. It's not the only fungus that produces galactomannan, but it's by far the most common. And it's the best test there is for diagnosing invasive pulmonary aspergillosis. The values are slightly lower for Aspergillus flavus infections compared with fumigators, but probably not enough to render the test unhelpful. Levels in the BAL less than 0.8 usually are not significant, and if they're less than 0.5, they're almost always insignificant. And if they're very high at more than 3, then they usually mean the patient has invasive aspergillosis. So in COPD and influenza patients and other medical patients, if a galactomannan test is done early after admission, particularly into intensive care, the knowledge that the patient has invasive aspergillosis and giving the appropriate treatment can be life-saving. We and others have looked at sputum galactomannan, and there's a lot more galactomannan in sputum, and the cutoff is not very certain. So we don't recommend this as a routine test. And then the final element of making a diagnosis of aspergillosis is with tissue samples and aspirates. So if a tissue is obtained and there's a question about whether a patient may have a fungus infection or not, then direct microscopy using Gram stains, AFB and fungal stains are appropriate. It's important to culture this tissue, preferably not homogenizing it, because that renders many otherwise viable fungal hyphae non-viable. And then, of course, histopathology should be done. And if there's a real question of a fungal disease, then the special stains for fungi should be done at the same time as the H&E stains. So on tissue, you can also look for galactomannan. You can do an Aspergillus or panfungal PCR. There are various in-house methods for immunohistochemistry or immunofluorescence stains. And even on fixed tissue, you can do an 18S or ITS PCR with sequencing to work out which fungus is involved. The volume of tissue obtained is very important. And we also know that antifungal therapy reduces the culture yield. So tests done late in the course of therapy after a lot of antifungal therapy are more likely to be negative. So now just a couple of words about galactomannan. This is a complex sugar, multi-chain sugar, composed of units of galactose and mannose, and it varies in length and structure depending on the organism and probably within individual strains within different species. You can find galactomannan in guar gum from the guar bean, and that's used in the food industry extensively as a material for stabilizing things like ice cream and cream cheese and salad dressings. There's quite a lot of galactomannan in seaweed. Children or adults given ice pops may have positive galactomannan levels. And some antibiotics, when they're synthesized or produced in fermentation, and there's some leftover galactomannan in the vial, and that can give you a false positive. This used to be a common problem. It's less common these days, but it still does occur. Several different species of fungi produce galactomannan in addition to aspergilli. For example, Penicillium chrysogenum or digitatum. Tellurimycetes, or what was called Penicillium marneffei, is also a producer of galactomannan, as is Pacillomyces, Chytomium. Histoplasma produces galactomannan, and so if you do not have access to histoplasma antigen test, you could use a galactomannan test as a surrogate for that. And some species of fusarium also produce a small amounts of galactomannan. As I mentioned, Aspergillus flavus produces a little bit less than fumigatus, but it's still enough to be able to make a diagnosis. And disseminated histoplasmosis and talaromycosis can be diagnosed with galactomannan. Now I'm going to show you three videos looking at the different methods of doing galactomannan. The first is the Bio-Rad Platelia galactomannan assay. This is widely used across the world.
This is a very straightforward test that can be carried out in the laboratory and is designed to pick up large cell wall components that are released from Aspergillus whilst it's growing in the patient. The test is an ELISA test, and the facilities needed by the laboratory are quite simple. A good set of pipettes, an incubator, and of course good laboratory practice. Samples are sent from the clinic or the ward, and these can be either blood samples or samples of lavage fluid that have been recovered from the lungs. Samples are processed in the laboratory and then they're added to the ELISA plate that comes with the kit for this particular assay. These are the available standard reagents available for the assay. There's an incubation step of 90 minutes, after which more reagents are added to the ELISA plate, and then the results are read in a microtiter plate reader. This then can generate printout, and the results can be interpreted, and depending on what sort of system you have in your laboratory, they can be released electronically to whoever has requested the test, or they can be telephoned to the requesting clinician. Here we have the printout from the galactomannan reader. The template incorporates negative threshold and a positive control. Patient samples are added in duplicate in most cases if there's enough material. And the optical density from the reader can be used to calculate an index, the level of galactomannan in that patient's sample. And based on the strength of that signal, we can predict whether or not the patient does have invasive aspergillosis. The Aspergillus galactomannan test is rapid, it's robust, it has good specificity and sensitivity. Unfortunately, There are many reasons for false positives, which have to be explored for individual patients. Finally, it's highly recommended in recent guidelines to support the diagnosis of invasive aspergillosis.
The second is the Dynamica galactomannan kit. This was first commercialised about 5 or 6 years ago and is used quite extensively in China and some other parts of the world.
In this video, we demonstrate how to perform Dynamica Aspergillus galactomannan assay, also known as GMIC. Before starting the test, take out the GM test kit from the refrigerator and place at room temperature for 30 minutes. To perform the test, ensure that you have all the required consumables and equipment, pipettes, tips, timer, reservoir, marker plate frame, 1.5 milliliter centrifuge tubes and rack, vortex, centrifuge, water bath or heat block, and marker plate reader. Also make sure that the incubator has equilibrated at 37 degrees. The heat block has been set to 100 degrees. Step 1. Sample preparation. One, add 300 microliter of serum, BAL, negative control R2, cutoff control R3, positive control R4, into screw-capped EP tubes. Two, add 100 microliter of sample treatment solution R6 into each tube. Three. Vortex mixture for 10 seconds. 4. Centrifuge tubes at 10,000 G for 5 seconds. 5. Heat tubes by heat block at 100 degrees for 6 minutes. Alternatively, place the tubes in water bath for 3 minutes. 6. Take out the tubes and the centrifuge at 10,000 G for 10 minutes. 4 degrees is recommended if the centrifuge is refrigerated. Step 2. ELISA performing. 1. Prepare the washing solution. R7. Concentrated washing solution. The concentrated washing solution can be easily diluted to the working concentration by combining with the appropriate volume of distilled water. In this test, we used one portion of concentrated washing solution with 19 portions of distilled water. 2. Take the microtiter strips out of the sealed bag. Return the unused strips and reseal the pouch tightly. Stored at 2 to 8 degrees until next time use. R2. Negative control. Add 100 microliter of supernatant of treated negative control serum into one well. R3. Cutoff control. Add 100 microliter of supernatant of treated cutoff control serum into two wells. R4. Positive control. Add 100 microliter of supernatant of treated positive control serum into one well. Samples. Add 100 microliter of supernatant of treated serum or BAL samples. Seal the plate and shaking for 10 seconds before incubating at 37 degrees for 16 minutes. After 16 minutes, gently remove the plate sealer and shake out the solution. Add 300 microliters of washing solution to each vial and leave it for 40 seconds. Attention! The 40 seconds soaking time is very important. After 40 seconds, completely remove all the liquid from each vial by tapping the plate firmly on clean absorbent paper. Only one time wash is needed here. Here are some tips for the users of microplate washer. 1. Please ensure that pipes and needles are clean and smooth for washing step. 2. Only use provided washing solution from dynamic GMIC. 3. Please ensure that 40 seconds soaking time is included in the program. 4. Tap the plate firmly on clean absorbent paper until no liquid remaining in the vial after each washing. R5. Conjugate. Add 100 microliters of conjugate in each vial. Alternatives. This step can be easily achieved by using a multi-channel pipette. Keep in mind that the volume of the reagent in reservoir should be 10% greater than exact volume that you would like to transfer to the ELISA plate. Rinse the tips with the reagents to ensure that all the tips are pipetting at equal volume before adding into the vials. Seal the plate and incubate in the incubator at 37 degrees for 30 minutes. After 30 minutes, wash the plate as previous instruction. 3 times a wash is needed here. Ensure 40 seconds soaking time between each wash. R8. Substrate solution. After the final wash, add 100 microliters of the substrate solution R8 into each vial. Alternatives. If you are using a multi-channel pipette, prepare 10% extra reagent in the reservoir, rinse the tips, and make sure there is no leakage of the reagent occurred. Incubate the plate in dark at 37 degrees for 25 minutes. Do not seal the plate. After 25 minutes, R9, stopping solution. Stop the reaction by adding 50 microliters of stopping solution. After stopping the reaction of the ELISA plate, results should be assessed within 5 minutes in a microplate reader for absorbance at 450 nanometer. Step 3. Send report. Thank you for watching.
And then the third test is a lateral flow test produced by a UK company. And this is actually a different antigen, not galactomannan, but a manna protein assay with similar results to galactomannan, but has the advantage of being quite simple. And there's one other of these tests also becoming available from IMI. Thank you. So how should these assays be interpreted? There are false positive assays in children, particularly very young children, less than 3 years, partly because of the diet when they're hospitalised with leukemia or having had a transplant, and also because they have a large amount of bifidobacterium in their gut, and this produces galactomannan. Some patients with multiple myeloma have a positive Aspergillus antigen. As I mentioned, some antibiotics, and particularly piperazo, is one of the antibiotics which sometimes contains galactomannan. Some patients who've had a stem cell transplant have a positive galactomannan after resolution of neutropenia for reasons that are not completely clear, but maybe due to disturbance of their GI tract. And enteral nutrition also can generate positive galactomannan assays in blood. You can have false negatives in hemolyzed specimens in patients with hyperbilirubinemia. Quite a lot of blood tests are negative in solid organ transplant patients in terms of their serum not containing antigen, even though they have life-threatening infection. And it may be partly complex by Aspergillus antibodies that are present, although the relationship with Aspergillus antibody and antigen is not well characterized. Last year in 2018, Andrew Ullman and colleagues presented the multi-tabled guidelines for the diagnosis and management of invasive aspergillosis. And one of the tables in that is the galactomannan testing on blood samples. And I just want to point out to you the top two elements of this, where there's a strong recommendation for screening for invasive aspergillosis in patients who have had prolonged neutropenia or an allogeneic stem cell transplant, but only if they're not on mold-active prophylaxis. If they are on mold-active prophylaxis, the recommendation is not to do this. And so this is a very important distinction in terms of the yield of the test and whether the test should be used as a screening test or as a diagnostic test. There have been some meta-analyses of the utility of galactomannan in blood or serum, and these show that typically in the neutropenic patient or stem cell transplant patient that you have a sensitivity between about 70 and 90% and a specificity from 85 to 90%. So this is not a perfect test, but it's a good test, and it's a lot better than most of the other tests that can be done for invasive aspergillosis. When you deal with non-neutropenic patients, such as those who had a solid organ transplant or an intensive care, the yield goes down substantially. And there are also only a small proportion of patients who have a positive antigen with chronic pulmonary aspergillosis. Again, probably those with the more severe end of that spectrum of disease. Once antifungal prophylaxis is given, particularly itraconazole, voriconazole, or posaconazole, that greatly reduces the utility of the galactomannan antigen testing. So in that context, regular screening during neutropenia is really not cost-effective. You may get positives if you do that screening, particularly if you have a breakthrough infection or possible breakthrough infection, but there's less confidence in negatives, and you also get some false positives in that context as well. So if you compare the utility of galactomannan with BTD-glucan and PCR in blood, as Lewis White did in a publication 4 or 5 years ago, overall, you can see that the galactomannan performs really quite well for invasive aspergillosis with around an 82% sensitivity and 92% specificity, which is marginally better than glucan and similar to Aspergillus PCR in these neutropenic patients. The Aspergillus PCR test is also not useful outside neutropenia in terms of the blood testing, although it's useful in respiratory fluids. Now, if you have a bronchoscopy option, then this is the very best way to establish the diagnosis of invasive pulmonary aspergillosis. So medical ICU patients, particularly steroid-treated patients or COPD or influenza, will have a positive galactomannan in most cases if they have invasive aspergillosis. In transplant, it's helpful. It's also helpful in liver failure, in various forms of leukemia and relapsed lymphoma, if you can do a bronchoscopy, patients with AIDS. It's also frequently positive in patients with chronic pulmonary aspergillosis. And so in patients with an uncertain cavitary infiltrate with a possibility of tuberculosis or lung cancer, then in addition to doing tests for TB and biopsies for lung cancer, a galactomannan is a very helpful additional test in that group to clarify whether they may have chronic pulmonary aspergillosis or if they have lung cancer, actually invasive pulmonary aspergillosis alongside their lung cancer. So this summary table from one centre study epitomises the results that are seen in the literature in many, many studies, with culture positive in about a third of the patients, antigen positive in almost all, in this case all of the patients, and PCR positive in almost all the cases as well. But what's also important to note is that the Aspergillus antigen test falls to zero very quickly after antifungal therapy is given. So it's important to, if a bronchoscopy is going to be done, to do that bronchoscopy early in the course. There have been many studies looking at the precise cutoff for BAL, galactomannan, and this study published in 2012 did exactly that. And you can see a large range of different values here depending on the sensitivity and specificity. And so broadly speaking, optical density galactomannan of more than 0.8 is the optimal cutoff. The cutoff for BAL has been studied in multiple publications, and it does depend partly on how the BAL is obtained and how much dilution of respiratory fluids there is. This study shows you an example of what is in the literature, where an OD index of 0.8 or greater was consistent with invasive aspergillosis, and many labs use 1.0 as their cutoff. If it's more than 3, the OD, then it's highly likely to represent invasive aspergillosis with high specificity. And if it's less than 0.5, then it usually rules out invasive aspergillosis. So that is quite helpful in interpretation, but it's not a precise science. In intensive care units, in non-neutropenic patients and otherwise not immunocompromised patients, Aspergillus antigen can be detected in respiratory fluids, whether it's a non-directed bronchial lavage or a BAL. And in this pivotal study published in 2008, showed a sensitivity of 88% and a specificity of 87%. So not a perfect test, but it's the best test that we have for picking up invasive aspergillosis in this setting. You'll notice that the sensitivity of the BAL galactomannan was twice that of culture, and that serum galactomannan detection was always negative. So now the strategy in many of the best units in the world who see these complicated patients with medical problems going into ICU is to do a fast bronchoscopy and check that there are no tracheobronchial lesions consistent with Aspergillus tracheobronchitis, and then take a BAL or a non-directed bronchial lavage fluid within the first 24 hours of admission to intensive care. And that is the most efficient means of diagnosing invasive aspergillosis. And in the context of influenza, where this is a particularly frequent problem, it's really quite important to do this. There are a few data looking at Aspergillus antigen in patients with AIDS. This 20-year study from France showed that somewhere between 40% and 50% of the patients had either a serum or BAL positive for Aspergillus antigen. And so this may be a useful test in these patients, even if it's, again, not a perfect test. There are many other samples that can be assessed for Aspergillus antigen. Pleural and pericardial fluid are two common examples. It's probably the best non-invasive test for CNS aspergillosis if spinal fluid can be obtained. And that is a helpful way of making that diagnosis, although often a biopsy or a section is done. Urine is currently unreliable, but there are efforts underway to improve that and use urine as a diagnostic method. Tissue can be processed for antigen, as I mentioned before. Sputum can be done, but the cutoff is much higher and there's a very large spread of results, which makes it a more difficult test to interpret. It's not reliable in sinus aspirates. That's been looked at carefully. And of course, you can pre-qualify batches of antibiotics or food for patients and check whether they have Aspergillus antigen if there is a problem with false positives in the hospital. And so it can be used in that way to understand why there's an apparent outbreak of Aspergillus antigenemia. In the guidelines, various different ways of approaching this were looked at, and you can see the BAL fluid got a strong recommendation. The spinal fluid not quite so strong, and lung biopsy is not quite so strong, but still a positive recommendation for use. This complicated table looks at combinations of tests, and this is an important aspect of making a diagnosis of invasive aspergillosis or ruling it out. As a general statement, two positive tests mean that you have disease and two negative tests mean that you do not have disease. But there are many combinations within that. And this study, and I'm not going to go through the detail of it, shows you the relative diagnostic odds ratios of different combinations. So if you take the middle one, PCR on respiratory fluids and a galactomannan in serum of 0.5, either or both of those combinations gave you the best diagnostic odds ratio with a sensitivity of 62% and 100% specificity. But it depends on whether you want to rule the infection in or rule it out as to how these tests are best used. As I mentioned before, there are limited data suggesting that Aspergillus antigen could be used for diagnosing disseminated histoplasmosis. So in this moderately large series from French Guiana, where they have a lot of histoplasmosis in the context of AIDS, you can see the relative diagnostic approaches that were used included direct exam, culture, a specific PCR, and you can also see the galactomannan detection was positive in about 82% of the patients. And that, therefore, is a helpful test in some of these patients to make a diagnosis. Likewise, in disseminated talaromycosis, and this study from China looked at this in some detail, and they found a sensitivity of 96% and a specificity of 91% if they used a cutoff of 1.0. So in summary, Aspergillus are unique amongst microorganisms in the breadth of infections, including allergies that they produce. And because of these different manifestations of disease, the way that diagnosis should be approached is different. And to optimize diagnosis, more than one assay is almost certainly required. Aspergillus IgE and Aspergillus IgG are the most useful tests for chronic and allergic forms of aspergillosis. Aspergillus antigen testing is most useful in the acute setting to identify invasive aspergillosis, and it should be reported urgently. So this is not a test that should take 3 to 4 days, but should be run as fast as it can be on a very regular basis. The highest diagnostic performance is in BAL and possibly also in CSF. It's important that the actual cutoffs of these different assays are thought about in detail for the particular population that's being studied. Blood cultures for Aspergillus are almost always negative. Cultures from respiratory fluids are helpful if they're positive, but they frequently are not. And sometimes they can be false positive in the sense that the patient has an organism colonising their airways. Aspergillus antigen and PCR are definitively more sensitive than culture in making a diagnosis of any form of aspergillosis, but particularly invasive aspergillosis. There are a number of references here which you can link in to help in terms of reading up about this subsequently.
Okay, thank you, Professor Denning, for a very detailed and exhaustive webinar on the use of galactomannan and its practical applications in various clinical settings. So, participants, we have about 15 minutes for some questions. You've had plenty of time to think up some very, very difficult ones. We'll start off with a question, very topical. Professor Denning, how can you use, and we've seen this a lot in the literature very recently, how can we use the galactomannan test result specifically in bowel samples from COVID-19 patients? How do we distinguish, can we, between colonization and infection?
That's a very interesting question. Thank you for asking it, and it's very topical, clearly. One study from France suggested about 30% of patients with COVID-19 pneumonia on a ventilator had invasive aspergillosis. The imaging often shows a halo sign in these patients if you do a CT scan around a nodule, but that may or may not represent invasive aspergillosis because in situ infarction and clotting is an intrinsic part of the COVID-19 disease. So imaging alone may or may not represent invasive aspergillosis. Some of these patients are too ill to do a bronchoscopy on or to take a sample from because they're so oxygen dependent. But if this is possible, then an antigen test can be done. And in the French series, it was positive from memory in about 60 to 70% of patients, I think. And some of them had a positive culture as another way of indicating that the diagnosis is possible. It's much more likely to have invasive aspergillosis if the patient has been treated with steroids, we think. The case control work hasn't been done, but that was clearly the case with influenza, and it's very likely to be the case with COVID-19 as well.
Yes, of course, there's been a bit of confusion, hasn't there, about the terminology, because in the ERTC hematology world, we talk about possible and probables, and we've noticed from one of the French publications, they use the word putative. So there is this ongoing discussion, exactly what do we mean, and how we define the possibility of invasive aspergillosis in these patients. So what you're saying is that we can't really come up with an index, a cutoff, a threshold at the moment when we do this test on bowels from these patients.
I doubt that it would be different than influenza and other ICU patients. And so I think if you have a very high GM or a positive manor protein assay with the LFT, then I think this patient will almost certainly have invasive aspergillosis. What's more difficult is if you have a slightly raised OD, for example, 1.1 or 0.9, there I think it's more complex and more difficult. Probably these patients should be treated if there's any doubt, though, because the mortality in ICU from COVID-19 at the moment is roughly 50%. So if the rate of invasive aspergillosis is indeed 30% and none of those patients are treated, we wouldn't expect many to survive.
Thank you very much. Okay, another very practical question, and this is something that we here in Manchester have experienced. So the question is, the diet of hospitalized patients could include yogurt, which we know contains the bacterium, bifidobacterium. Could this influence the test?
In patients with leaky bowels, so small children, those with chemotherapy, patients with enteral nutrition with a very large amount of galactomannan being fed to them, may give you a false positive. But I think in a setting where the GI tract is intact or pretty intact and hasn't had any major insults, that's not going to be a very common problem.
Yes, indeed. So our particular case a few years ago, this was a neonate and we had a GM index of 12. So that immediately triggers a line of inquiry, doesn't it? And we did find out that bifidobacterium had been isolated from the GI tract of this youngster. So it's becoming a well-recognized false positive factor. And then, of course, there was this lovely case report a couple of years ago in the New England Journal of Medicine where a lady following a stem cell transplant had very high GM indices. And, of course, the reaction was to treat this patient with voriconazole. And it turned out that it was because she was eating, sucking about 12 ice pops, ice lollies a day. Yeah. And you mentioned this at the very beginning of your lecture, that there are these stabilizers in various dietary products which can contribute to these false positive results. So I think it's having an understanding of what can contribute to these very high indices.
Yes, so I think pasta and yogurts also often contain quite a lot of galactomannan.
And following on, again, from a comment you made earlier on, here is a question. Is there any data about the application of the GM test for aspergillosis due to non-fumigatus, non-flavus aspergillus species?
Yes, all aspergillus species and indeed penicillium species produce galactomannan. We know that the patients with Aspergillus flavus infections have a slightly lower overall galactomannan than fumigatus infections. And we also know that in patients with Aspergillus terreus or Niger infections, you do have detectable galactomannan, but we don't have a relative amount to know whether the cutoff should change in that context. It may be about how much a galactomannan is produced, and it may also be the reactivity of that galactomannan with the antibody that's used to detect it. So it's not necessarily how much the organism produces of GM.
Okay, so this is really following on from one of the previous questions, but it's an important topic to discuss. So somebody is asking, according to the difficulties of obtaining bowel samples from COVID-19 patients, and we don't see a lot of those sorts of samples here, how do you interpret the galactomannan test on serum in these patients?
So there's quite a big Indian study by somebody called Dabas and colleagues in Delhi, and they found that in ICU patients, some of whom had hematological disease, but most of them were sort of general ICU patients, that around a third of the patients had an elevated serum galactomannan, and if they had a very high galactomannan, that was linked to mortality. So I think you've got a very variable spread, particularly in the non-neutropenic patients, about how much galactomannan is released into blood. And there are probably multiple reasons for that. The load of Aspergillus disease, the species that's causing it, whether there's any pre-existing antibody or whether that the macrophage function and elimination function of the patient in terms of excreting or digesting galactomannan is also relevant, and possibly their renal filtration rate as well. So there's probably multiple factors leading to a lot of variability.
And I suppose the obvious follow-on from that discussion is, think there's any value? Would it be interesting to determine antibody titers in these patients, IgG, IgM? Of course, we know they produce antibodies to COVID.
Yes.
Any value in looking for Aspergillus antibodies?
People who have detectable Aspergillus antibodies have produced them to multiple different antigens, commonest of catalase and DPPV and other protein antigens. But they do produce anti-galactomannan antibodies. And we know that partly because one of the antibody tests that's on the market is an anti-galactomannan antibody that Dynamica produce, and it's positive in a large percentage of patients with chronic pulmonary aspergillosis. Now, how effective that is in binding the galactomannan and whether there's enough antibody or there's more antigen present than is antibody, and what happens to that antibody and whether it dissociates when you try and measure galactomannan is not well understood. So one of the reasons for this heating step at the beginning of the galactomannan testing procedure is to try and dissociate any antibody antigen complex at that stage.
So there's a question here, and I suspect the questioner is asking whether or not this test can be used for the diagnosis of sporotrichosis. Does Sporothrix actually elaborate? Does it produce galactomannan? So the question is, do we work with sporotrichosis diagnosis? Anything known about Sporothrix and galactomannan?
Yes, it's in the UK, it's a very rare disease, as you yourself know. And I don't think there's any literature on that. I haven't looked at it recently to know that for sure. Sporothrix is fairly close phylogenetically to histoplasma. So it is possible that it does produce galactomannan, but it tends to be a fairly slow chronic infection. There are rare cases of Sporothrix meningitis, and it may be that GM would be one of the ways of at least considering that diagnosis in that context.
So here in the UK last week, I think it was, we had the first isolation diagnosis of sporotrichosis in a cat. But I don't think the GM test was used to confirm that diagnosis.
No,
that was an interesting case report, though. Okay, so I think it's quite natural that we're now getting a few questions here about lateral flow devices. So in a patient with a challenge of collecting a bowel or doing a bronchoscopy, has there been any evaluation of the Aspergillus antigen LFD for sputum?
Not published to my knowledge. I think you did a very little bit of work on this about 5 years ago in Manchester in a prototype LFD with the mannoprotein antigen. And it was positive in many of the samples, but not all of them. I haven't seen any published work on this. Part of the reason for that is that people tend to focus on invasive aspergillosis, and those patients produce very little sputum. So the work tends to be done in patients with chronic or allergic aspergillosis, and there you don't usually have a positive blood antigen or even a test for antigen, and they don't always have a corresponding BAL at a similar time frame. So it's difficult to correlate it. So I don't think I know the answer to that. And because it's not quantitative, I think it would be important to do the work carefully, because it may be that it could overread it if one's not careful.
Okay, and again, a very practical question here, and something that we have been grappling with, I suppose, over the last many weeks. Professor Denning, what's your recommendation about the principle of galactomannan testing in the COVID era? Do we need to modify the test protocols, particularly to overcome very infectious samples? So I think they're talking about infection control, protecting the staff, and minimizing the liberation of aerosols into the immediate environment where this test is being carried out.
So in an intubated patient, aspiration should be into a closed system if it can be, rather than open aspiration. But clearly clearing the airways in an ICU patient is something that's done routinely. there is a risk, I think, to the operator of doing a bronchoscopy in some of these patients, and I think that's a definite reason for not doing it. On the other hand, some of these patients are critically ill, and making a diagnosis of invasive aspergillosis is an important part of that evaluation in that context, particularly, as I've said, if they receive steroids. So if a sample is obtained, and I accept that that won't always be the case, my view is that in addition to doing studies for ventilator-assisted pneumonia or VAP, that the galactomannan should be done. One of the easiest ways of doing that is supplying the category level 3 labs where most of these samples will get processed with the lateral flow devices, either the one that we showed or IMI's galactomannan lateral flow device, because then it can be done in that laboratory without sample exiting. But it also, the sample could be heated, and because we know that galactomannan is heat stable, and then transferred to another laboratory for a galactomannan assay, such as the BioRad or the Dynamica assays. So I think there are several different options, but speed is clearly important in these patients.
It's an obvious question, I think. How do the three galactomannan assays compare?
Yes, I think that's an important question. I will let the person who's asked that question look it up. There have been some direct LFD-GM comparisons published. There are not very many comparisons of different ELISA, galactomannan ELISAs, of IRAD, Dynamica assays published, and there have been LFD to LFD comparisons as well published. All of them in the context of GM, to my knowledge, and all of them relatively small numbers of patients. So I think this is an area which really does need to be explored, and it is conceivable that in one group of patients, such as an ICU patient, one of these assays would perform a lot better than another one for technical reasons or related to the amount of antigen binding or to the relevant antibody in the test. So I think these more assessments are definitely required in this area.
And just to remind the participants that there is a video on the LIFE website demonstrating how to take respiratory samples more safely. So that's really worth having a look at. Now, this is an interesting question. This is from Ghana. Fusarium species is the most common causative agent in fungal keratitis. Can GM testing be helpful since Fusarium species produce galactomannan?
Yes, it's an interesting question. The usual problem with keratitis is the sample volume is tiny, and the normal input volume for a galactomannan ELISA is 100 microliters. So you would have to be substantially diluted. And there's a lot to do with that sample anyway, doing direct microscopy with more than one stain, bacterial culture, fungal culture, and also considering acanth amoeba as another differential diagnosis as well. So I don't think in most contexts that would be very practical, but it is something that it's quite likely that a small amount of galactomannan would be detectable from patients with Fusarium. Fusarium can, of course, disseminated disease as well in hematology patients and pulmonary disease, but usually the galactomannan is negative in those patients or only just positive.
That's a surprising observation, isn't it? Because we know that in those sorts of patients, blood cultures for Fusarium are quite often positive. So you might expect there would be a level of galactomannan in the circulation, but you're right. It's very rarely detected in those patients with pretty obvious fulminant fusariosis. Okay, well, I think we've come to the end of the Q&A session. Many thanks to those of you who have asked questions. I've posed the questions to Professor Denning, most of these questions. So once again, to all the participants, we hope that you've enjoyed this, this first of these webinars. And thank you, David, for giving us these very illuminating lectures. Thank you.
Thank you all very much for watching. And here are some additional links that you can use, as well as the information about the microscopy course that is available online in multiple languages. Many thanks.